My sisters and brothers, it is good to be together here at the principal church of the Archdiocese of Detroit. Even this building is catechetical. These statues you see around the nave are the teachers, are my first teachers in church. Father Mack has placed them there, and it's a wonderful use of these awesome statues which came from St. Benedict in Highland Park. This church is the bishop's episcopal seat, and to which your own parish, church, and school are intimately united in the bond of charity. Under the spiritual fatherhood of our ordinary, Archbishop Alan Vigneron. Archbishop Vigneron was a Catholic school student, and it is from these roots in his family and local parish that his faith was nourished and grew until he could become still enough to hear the Lord's invitation to follow him as a priest, then later as a bishop. When Archbishop Vigneron was a boy, I can't imagine that he could have imagined what God had planned for him. Scripture tells us that eye has not seen nor ear heard what God has for those who love him. God has something beyond your imagination for you too. Something you can't at this moment even consider. I promise you, though, the path to discover that plan, the plan God intends for you, goes right through Jesus. It will emerge as you follow Jesus, as you learn Jesus, as you learn his ways, as you learn his heart, as you learn his desires, and yes, you learn his plans for you. I want to tell you a secret this morning. Jesus' heart is overflowing with love for you. He literally aches for you and your love this very day, and indeed every day. He aches until you are with him forever, and he aches until you and I and all of us ache for him too. People don't always understand this, but it is the Father's plan to reestablish all creation in his Son Jesus. Jesus wants to make us like him. He wants us to imitate him. He wants us to seek always the Father's will for us. He wants us to keep his commandments as a visible sign of our love for him, a sign that others can see, like these statues that surround the nave, as a sign others can see that Jesus is not just an idea in your mind, but a person alive in your heart, whom you press into in faith with all the powers of your body and your soul. Jesus desires a visible sign from us, but not before he gives us a visible sign from him of his love for you and me. He gives us his name. He gives us his sacrifice on our behalf. He gives us his blood to wash and heal us. He gives us his resurrection so we can live now in hope. He bids each of us and all of us to follow him. To follow him is a new way of living, of dying and rising on behalf of our brother, our neighbors, and in our own self-gift in imitation of him. He gives us most magnificently of all in the Eucharist. His entire self, not symbolically, but truly, so that he might be with us as he promised us to the end of time, that he might heal and nourish and wondrously conform us to himself, to make us into whom the Father intends all creation to be. The Eucharist, the mystery of the real presence of Christ, for which this church is named as a visible memorial and representation of God's everlasting promise, is something to which every Christian and every human being is meant to be conformed, and by which we are transformed by the power of the Spirit of God. You and me, just ordinary men and women, ordinary boys and girls, are as planned by God, meant to bear in our person the real presence of Christ, to be Christophers, Christ bearers, or as Archbishop Vigran wrote, to become living tabernacles, bearing Christ's presence in our person into the world. Think of this. Think how profoundly sacred you are to be a living vessel bearing Christ wherever you go. God loves you so much that he's willing to trust the living and real presence of his Son to you and to me. That means that because we have been chosen to be Christ bearers, we are sacred and set apart for the most noble of purpose of all, to be a minister of the sacrament of Jesus's body and blood, so that he can, in you, touch and encounter every human being and every creature in the world. The Eucharist is God's living presence. So are you, in a manner appropriate to your vocation and the share in the mission he entrusts to you. Jesus is with you and is calling you by name. He says to you this very day, follow me. He gives us the sacraments and the command of virtuous living to help us on the journey of transformation. Nowhere in life is there a more profound, powerful, and holy manifestation of Christ and his church than when the holy sacrifice of the Mass is offered. In the Mass, the body of Christ, the head and members of the church, are made visible to all the world. Nowhere is there an opportunity with the same profundity to join our sacrifice to Jesus' sacrifice, that through our laying down our lives along with Christ in his one and true sacrifice, and picking up the very life of Christ, consuming him in the Eucharist, so that our bodies might have in themselves resurrected life, so that being transformed by, with, and through Jesus, in the power of the Spirit of God, we join our lives to his mission and grow in his likeness. You see, the fundamental reason your parents send you to a Catholic school is that though they know that being conformed to Jesus Christ is the single and most important transformation you will undergo in your life and is the key to the life and the joy the Father has planned for you. Following Jesus and becoming like him is the single most important thing that can happen to any person in the entirety of their lives. Your Catholic school is vital in laying a foundation so that building on what God is doing for you in the Eucharist and what your families have laid down for you will enable you to soar to the wonders God and your parents desire for each and all of you. Jesus is the most loving and kind being I've ever encountered, and he loves us all profoundly. He comes to us so gently in Holy Communion, not as a conquering warrior, but as the tenderest of friends, who knows us inside and out, and is not repelled by our smallness, but who desires to envelop us in his loving heart and whisper his love, his encouragement, his direction to our hearts. It is right that we honor Jesus with our reverence and worship as we kneel before him during the recalling of the Passion, and we prepare to receive his body with our bodies. We humble ourselves to receive him as he himself does in giving himself to us. We receive him on our tongues or on our hands. But we, my brothers and sisters, must not stop there. We must receive him above all in our hearts. We must go back to our pew after communion, and as we kneel in silence, as we whisper to him, just as the prophet Samuel did, and say, "Speak these simple yet profound words. Speak, Lord. Your servant is listening." Let him speak to your heart. Learn to hear his voice in the silence. Let him teach you, inform you in his mission, in his person, in his love. Every day, even if you can't be at Mass, allow some time for silence and allow him to draw you into communion with him, even if it's for 10 minutes. But to teach you his desires and to share with you his plans for your prospering in love. My dear ones, you will spend a good deal of time seeking excellence in various important matters, matters both big and small. There is one thing you must become an expert in, however, and this will be the single most important task to spend the power of your youth on. Seek excellence in your relationship with Christ. Learn him. Spend time with him and give yourself to him, an imitation of how he gives himself to you. Allow the risen one to teach you, to form you, to make you like himself, so that before all else, you will be his ambassador, his herald, his living bearer of his loving presence into the world. Jesus is a person, and he seeks the love of children, of men and women, whom he gave his full self for their salvation and flourishing, and who remains with us in his Eucharistic presence until all things are caught up in him and given over to him, given over to our Heavenly Father. My sisters and brothers, God is with us. It's not a slogan that we simply say at Christmas time, Emmanuel. God is with us, and he seeks those of us to lay down our lives at his feet, to say to him as he says to us, "Speak, Lord, your servants are listening." And he replies with a heart filled with love and the tenderness of intentions, "Come follow me." Amen.
Amen.